when I began the process, I just didn't like the regulations because I thought, well, they're kind of nebulous and they don't make a lot of sense. And when we started investigating, what we found is that the plan is really very organized and very well put together. The plan is to move education away from what we have right now, which is traditional education. That's, you have so many Carnegie units, you had 4 classes of math and 4 classes of English and so many classes of history to graduate, to what is called outcome-based education. Outcome-based education says that the student must demonstrate something in order to meet the goal and be promoted or graduate. In the traditional system, said this is an A, this is a B, this is a C, this is a D, this is an E, and you fit wherever you fit. Now, you had so much time in order to do that, so, you know, you had 180 days, and then the achievement went up or down according to that. In outcome-based education, the theory is everybody gets an A, or everybody gets a B, and however long it takes you to get there is okay. If you can get there in 3 days, then you graduate in 3 days. If it takes you 10 years, then you graduate in 10 years. Everything rides on the goals and on meeting the goals. So instead of saying the schools will teach, the theory now is the student will demonstrate. And so it's a major shift in the way we look at education. In order to understand that, I want you to think of a telephone salesman. If you ever gotten a call, telephone call from a telephone salesman, you pick up the phone and the salesman says, hi, he asks you 3 or 4 questions. I'm selling purple shoes tonight, so I want to know, are you a shoe owner? And you say yes or no, and I say, do you like the color purple? And you say yes or no. Do you buy your own shoes, or does your husband buy your shoes, or your wife buy your shoes, or your children buy your shoes, or does some other person buy your shoes for you? And you say yes or no. That's my pretest. I have just established the baseline data, now I know where you are, so I can begin teaching you about why you need purple shoes. That's the pretest. Now that I've established that, I'm going to do my sales pitch, and I'm going to give you 10 reasons why you really, really need purple shoes, and you can't live without them, and you want them. That's the curriculum. I have taught you something. I'm done now. Would you like to put that, Mrs. Smith, on your Visa or on your MasterCard? That's the post-test. I am assessing you to see if you have met my goal or not. My goal is that you're going to buy my shoes. You say, put it on my Visa. You have met the goal. I'm going to say thank you very much, and you may graduate from this conversation, and I'm going to hang up. You say, no, you have not met the goal. I am going to say, well, why not? What is your objection? And you're going to tell me, and I am going to remediate you. I'm going to put you through another sales pitch to make you want my purple shoes. That's remediation. You're going to walk that loop with me one more time, and at the end of the remediation, I'm going to say, should I put this on your Visa or your MasterCard? I'm testing you again. That's a reassessment. If you say, yes, you have met the goal, you may graduate from the conversation, and I'm going to hang up. If you say, no, I'm going to say, what is your objection? And I'm going to remediate you again and test you again. Now, if you would stay on the phone indefinitely, I would keep making you walk that remediation loop until you finally said, yes, you're going to buy my shoes, until you meet the goal. However, in a telephone sales call, you can say, excuse me, I've been remediated enough, I'm never meeting your goal, and you can hang up the phone. A child in a classroom cannot hang up the phone. They are going to be remediated again and again and again and again until they meet the goal. That's outcome-based education. Everything rests on the goals. That's the ladder that everything rests on. So when I started getting involved way back in the fall, I looked at the goals because that's what everything rests on. I thought I'd find geography, history, spelling, reading. I found adaptability to change, ethical judgment, self-esteem, family living, proper environmental attitude, understanding and appreciating others. And I went and met with Mr. Fear, who's the executive director of the State Board of Education in Pennsylvania, and I said, where did you get these? And with every goal, there was a list of exit outcomes. That's the specific behaviors that the child has to demonstrate in order to prove that they met the goal. The child just can't say, I met the goal, I understand others, isn't that great? The child has a list of behaviors that they have to demonstrate in order to prove that they met the goal. So I said to Mr. Fear, well, where'd you get the gold? And where did you get these exit outcomes? Where did they come from? And he said, oh, we had committees meet all over the state. And we brought together teachers and parents and other groups, and we got together and had consensus forming, and we reevaluated them and redid them, and they came up with over 500 student learning outcomes. And I said, well, okay, what did they base it on? He said, oh, nothing. We developed these specifically for Pennsylvania. I said, well, you mean when they went in and sat down, the table was empty? Oh, no, no. I said, well, what was on the table? Connecticut's goal. Oh, okay. So I wrote to Connecticut and said to Connecticut, would you please send me your goals? And Connecticut did send me their goals. And I sat down, and Connecticut's goals and Pennsylvania's goals were the same goals. Word for word, the same goals. Since then, we've gotten the goals from 26 different states. And this just gives you a little overview of what some of those exit outcomes are and how close they were. All students understand and appreciate their worth as unique and capable individuals and exhibit self-esteem. That's Pennsylvania's. Connecticut. Each student should be able to appreciate his or her worth as a unique and capable individual and exhibit self-esteem. Does that sound familiar? You can take all the student learning outcomes and match them up. It doesn't matter what state you're in. It doesn't matter whose outcomes you're looking at. If you strip the names of the states, you can't tell whose are whose. Now, the other states, they passed their goals and their exit outcomes on the first go-around. Pennsylvania, because of the involvement of parents like you and me and other ones across the state, have been forced to rewrite their student learning outcomes 7 times now. Some of these are from the first set that was first published in September. They published another set on March the 11th. That set included student learning outcomes that said that our children would exhibit the proper attitudes to live in the American constitutional democracy. We don't have a constitutional democracy. We have a democratic republic. The State Board of Education got the form of government wrong. So I went on the radio in Harrisburg and said, the State Board of Education doesn't know what their government is, much less what attitudes you need to live in it. So they rewrote those learning outcomes on March the 12th. That set lasted 24 hours. They're in their 7th rewrite now of student learning outcomes, and really, they haven't changed a bit. They've combined some, they've rearranged some, they've reorganized some, but the exit outcomes are still the same. Now, when you move to outcome-based education, there's a couple questions that you always have to ask. Because every child must demonstrate the goal, that means that, first of all, someone has to set a standard for what is mastery of this goal. How good is good enough? How much self-esteem is enough self-esteem? How much adaptability to change is too much adaptability to change? So first, we have to set a standard. Second, I have to test you in some way. I have to do an assessment to find out if you met my standard. Third, I have to remediate you. If you don't meet the standard, I have to bring in a curriculum or an activity or a program that will in some way change your behavior to make you meet my standard. Now, when you look at Pennsylvania's goals, we asked, what standards do you set, how do you test, how do you remediate? The state's response was, well, we're not real sure about that. So we went looking to see, well, what are you doing right now? Well, right now, Pennsylvania gives a test, since the 1960s. It was called the Educational Quality Assessment, or the EQA. It was given all the way up until 1989, when it was finally pulled. Each district took the EQA. It was given in grades 5, 8, and 11. Districts were required to write their long-range plan from the results of the EQA test, the Educational Quality Assessment test. In that plan, each district had to say how they were going to change their curriculum in order to make the children do better on that assessment the next time. Now, if you think about it, that makes sense. You know, if you give the same test in every district, and I give it in your district, and your district, and your district, and you were first, and you were second, but I'm sorry, you were last, what are you going to do? You're going to change your curriculum so you're not last anymore, because that's embarrassing. So the EQA was the basis for curriculum planning for all the districts in the state, and it was a mandatory test. The districts had to take it because they had to base their long-range plan on it in order to get their state money. What did the EQA test? The EQA tested first the 10, then the 12 quality goals of education. When we looked at the EQA, parents thought it was testing reading, writing, self-esteem, citizenship. It tested locus of control, whether you are an internally motivated person or an externally motivated person, whether you stand up against a crowd or whether you go with the flow. And they scored it. There was a right answer to the attitude question. The right answer was go with the flow. In citizenship, the EQA said it did not test anything in the factual domain. It didn't matter if you knew what the United Nations was. It didn't matter if you knew who the president was or what a president was. Citizenship tested thresholds of behavior. How do I vary reward and punishment to make you do what I want you to do? Sample question. There was an organization called the Midnight Marauders. They went out at midnight and spray painted all over everybody's walls. I would join the group if, A, my best friend were a member of the group. Child could say yes, no, or maybe. The correct answer was yes. I would join the group if all the popular kids were members of the group. Yes, no, or maybe. The correct answer was yes. I would join the group if my parents would ground me if they found out. The correct answer was no. You are supposed to avoid punishment, but you are supposed to honor commitments to friends and go with the group. The goal was collectivism. The EQA tested for adaptability to change. What parents were told was, well, you know, our world is constantly changing and we want people who are going to be able to go with that and survive that. We don't want rigid people who can't cope. Sounds very reasonable. The EQA tested and scored for rapid emotional adjustment to change without protest. That was the state desired response. The EQA just didn't test the attitudes of children, it scored the attitudes of children. It was a criterion reference test. That means there's a right answer and a wrong answer, and I say what it is. The bottom criteria for the EQA was that students would exhibit what the state called a minimum positive attitude. The 11th grade EQA was written on a reading level between 5th and 8th grade. The EQA, out of over 400 questions, 30 of them were academic, and 385 of them were attitudes. When the district took the EQA, they got back a list from the state of where they fit with other districts in the goal. They had to write their long-range plan in order to change their curriculum to have their children achieve the minimum positive attitude. Well, how did they do that? What did they change? The state said, we'll help you. And they brought in technical assistance, either in person or in what were called resources for improvement packets that the state made available to the districts. Those packets included lists of what were called validated programs. Those are programs from all over the country that had been tested by the federal government and had been proven to change the behaviors and attitudes of children in a specific subgroup. White male children with two parents who make less than $20,000 a year. All black female children in a single parent family who make more than $50,000 a year. They could divide the children up into what were called targeted subgroups based on your race, on gender, on ability level, on education of the parents, on socioeconomic status. And the programs were tested and then declared validated, meaning that they were proven to work to change the behaviors and attitudes of children in that subgroup. And that's what has been happening in Pennsylvania education since the 1960s. Our curriculum has been moving away from academics and into minimum positive attitude since the EQA. And the EQA is still driving the curriculum because districts used it for long-range planning up till 1989. Why did they stop? They stopped because a mother down in Washington County named Anita Hoag had a son who took the EQA. He came home and said, Mom, this test was really weird. She said, you must be wrong. I'm going to go down to the school and look. And she went down to the school and she said, I want to see the test. And they said, no. And she said, see, I'm the mommy. I'm allowed to see the test. And they said, no, you're not. It's a secure test. Nobody's allowed to see it. Big fine if you see it. Mrs. Hoag is the type of person that when you say no, she flunked locus of control, you know, made her want to do it more. So she wound up writing to the state and finally got a copy of the test and the scoring, which is how we got it. She filed a complaint with the Federal Department of Education alleging that the EQA was a violation of the Federal Hatch Act, federal law, that it was violating her rights to privacy, and it was against the psychological testing portion of that law, and the federal government agreed with her and said the EQA was a psychological test, it was in violation of law, and Pennsylvania had to enter into a consent agreement with the federal government, which resulted in policy being issued by our department, saying they wouldn't do it anymore. So what did Pennsylvania do with the consent agreement? Well, in 1988, when Mrs. Hoke's complaint began to surface, then Commissioner of Education Donna Wall issued a memo saying, we're going to withdraw the EQA until we incorporate it into the new Pennsylvania assessment system. In 1990, the Pennsylvania assessment system was first piloted. The first assessment was called the Pennsylvania Health Assessment. It says right on it, this is the revision of the EQA. This year, the Pennsylvania assessment system tested reading, math, and writing. Is it the same test? It has a different name, but their own documents say it's the revision of the EQA. In that 1988 memo, Mrs. Wall says that by 1993, we will have completed the revision process. If you look at the regulations that the state is promulgating right now, it says by 1993, the state will once again test all the goals. Timetable hasn't been interrupted at all. Initially, the sentence ended there. Now, because of the involvement of parents, it says, and parents have the right, they have to go back through public hearings to do that. Is that a victory? Not really. The regulatory process in our state really isn't controlled by the legislature. It's controlled by appointed bureaucrats who really don't care what you think. They sit at the meetings. They follow the letter of the law. They give the time. But your input is not really input. Example. In February of this year, the State Board held a public hearing on the student learning outcomes and the regulations. The room was big enough to hold 80 people, 500 showed up. They would not move the room. And we began the meeting with an attorney for the parents saying it would really be helpful to facilitate dialogue and consensus if we could get some really basic questions answered here. And the State Board said, we're not here to answer any questions. And he said, okay, I can appreciate that this is a public hearing and this is public comment and you're not here to answer any questions, but parents have been asking these questions now for 2 years. Where do they go to get the questions answered? And the State Board said, that's a matter of public policy, how you get your questions answered. And the attorney said, that's great. Could you explain the public policy to all these 500 people so they know what to do to get their questions answered? And the State Board said, we're not here to answer any questions. When you go to hearings, they give you a topic for the hearing. So one set of hearings is on the student learning outcomes, and one set of hearings is on the goals. Now, if you go in and say, but the whole program is terrible, they say, excuse me, the topic here is this piece of paper. So you have to confine your remarks to this piece of paper. So what happens? Well, in one of the goals, the original was that the personal, family, and community living, that the students will acquire and use the proper attitudes and behaviors necessary for successful personal, family, and community living. I testified to the Senate, in front of the Senate Education Committee, and said, what is a successful family? Two people cannot agree. How are you going to measure the attitudes necessary for it? Their response, they took out the word successful. So in order for parents to make a difference, they need to step outside the regulatory process and look at where do they go in order to drive the cart the way they want it to be driven. You go to the legislature. So in Pennsylvania, we went to the legislature and we asked for a resolution that would ask the Department of Education to slow down long enough for the House of Representatives to at least look at the regulations so that everybody could understand them, so there could be some real input. And we won that debate by a vote of 150-47, which is fairly significant. And the Department of Education said, we're doing it anyway. And they are doing it anyway. If you got involved now, what they would say to you is, this is a done deal. Nothing you can do about it, it's a done deal. Well, first of all, that's not true, because the student learning outcomes have not been passed in final form. No one has signed them. No one has even seen the final form yet. And secondly, the legislature has the power to override the bureaucracy if they want to. And that's where you get involved, is at the legislative level. You ignore the bureaucracy and focus on the elected people. That's where you need to be involved. So that's what parents did. What did the board do? The board continued to promote the regulations, and we continued to ask, where do these come from? How come all the goals in all the states are the same? We wound up looking at the federal level at what was called the New American Schools Development Corporation. New American Schools Development Corporation is part of America 2000, and it's the funding mechanism for the Break the Mold schools that everybody talks about. Now, the Break the Mold schools were supposed to be all these new ideas that everybody was going to have in order to change and make education better, and it was going to be novel and everyone would have a different idea. And we started pulling the proposals out of the New American Schools Development Corporation. There were 486 of them. We didn't pull them all. But all the ones we pulled were the same. Same goals, same method, outcome-based education. Same mechanism for working it. Outcome-based education has some flaws to it. When we asked the department, would you please give us your research base, they declined to do that. They told us that this was the best instincts of educators right now, and so we should just trust them that this is going to make it better. So we did our own research, and we found that in 1987, Johns Hopkins University issued a study saying outcome-based education doesn't work. And we found it was real expensive. Now, when you think about that, it makes a lot of sense. If I took any four people in my classroom, I'm the teacher, I only have four students, and I teach the lesson, and I test you, one of you will pass the test, three of you won't. That means I got to go back and reteach the three who didn't pass the test. What do I do with that one? Well, that one can sit and wait. That one